wonderful way to kick off this blessed first day of Holy Week, Palm Sunday, we celebrate our King. So that nothing distracts from our time together, please take a moment to silence your cell phones or digital devices. We'll have more news and prayer requests as we go along. But right now, we begin with the word of our Lord Jesus Christ. Please stand. And welcome to Zion Lutheran Church in Pasadena, Texas. I'm Pastor Brady, and today we celebrate Palm Sunday with all here or online. We welcome you in the precious name of Jesus. Our first reading from Zechariah chapter 9. And God promised, "Rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet humble, riding on a donkey's colt. I will remove the battle chariots from Israel and the war horses from Jerusalem. I will destroy all the weapons used in battle, and your king will bring peace to the nations. His realm will stretch from sea to sea and from the Euphrates River to the ends of the earth. Because of the covenant I made with you, sealed with blood, I will free your prisoners from death in a waterless dungeon. Come back to the place of safety, all you prisoners who still have hope. I promise this very day that I will repay two blessings for each of your troubles." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, save us now. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Hosanna, save us now. Come, Lord Jesus, come. We sing.
Oh,
People said, please be seated, and we sing in our hearts, Hosanna, which means save us now. But we also say other things in this blessed Holy Week, and God speaks to us as well. Here's a brief video to explain what happens this week.
Holy Week tells the story of Jesus, the story of our Savior and God's plan for us. On Palm Sunday, crowds cheer for an earthly king. Palms wave and shouts of praise ring Hosanna. And we see rich purple, the color of kings, on the altar. Maundy Thursday, one of faith's greatest mysteries began that night, the Lord's Supper.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
On Maundy Thursday, the altar is stripped bare, just as Jesus was stripped for us. Good Friday. God's good plan shines through even the darkest moments. We drape the cross in black, the lights dim, and our sins fall on our Savior.
"It is finished," he cried.
We leave in silence. Easter Sunday dawns bright and new with joyous songs of praise. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. We celebrate the new life we have in Christ.
In preparation for this blessed week, we remember the reason Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the cross in our place. So we began our worship service and this week with reflection on our sin and our need for our Savior. We pause for a private moment with him.
Thank you.
God's people said. We continue with our next reading for today.
In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. In being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The early church, 300 years after the death and resurrection of Jesus, shared this creed of what we believe, and you'll notice a longer portion about who Jesus is and what he did for us. Called the Nicene Creed, the church has been confessing this united for the last 1,700 years, and we do so as well. Please stand as we speak together our shared faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please remain standing for the gospel reading for today, after which we will enjoy our children's message. From Mark chapter 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing untying that colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated, and we invite our little ones to come on up for our children's message for today. And is our custom, we invite you to bring something in your hands, and we'll see if Pastor Brady can use that to talk about Jesus and God and His Word. Welcome. We're so glad. Oh, you're giggling already. This is going to be fun. Welcome, everyone. What an exciting service we've had already. Amen. All right. What do you have here? Your sister's cup. All right. I'll have some fun with that if the congregation votes that way. Ooh, what's this? A kazoo. How does a kazoo work? Oh, awesome. Awesome. Would have been perfect for the celebration. What do you have here?
Switch.
A switch game. Ooh, does it come apart? Ooh, a game. Oh, nice. All right. And what do you have here?
Whistle.
Hi. A whistle. Ooh, with a Pikachu on it. I like that. Wonderful. All right. So, sister's cup, show by applause. A switch, a whistle, and a kazoo. Well done. Please play the kazoo briefly while Pastor Brady figures out what he's going to say. So, how does it work? You're blowing in the wrong end, I think. Yeah, I know. I've used a kazoo before. You blow in this one. Nice. Very good. And so if you blew it to go along with the early song, it would be like... Very nice. Wonderful. Some people play the kazoo well, other people do not. We all have things that we do well for Jesus, and other things maybe not so much. But Jesus needs all of us to bring Him glory and celebrate, just like you heard in the gospel reading. Some people went to get the donkey. Some people had the donkey ready. Other people threw their cloaks over that, and other people celebrated. Oh, you're paying the switch. Cool, we can do that later. I love how God uses all of us in different ways, our musical skill, or in other ways to honor Jesus. And whether you have the skill at the kazoo or other things, or just in prayer, let us honor Jesus who gives us all things for His glory. And all God's people said, amen. All right, please head back to your seats as we hear our next song. And if you want to try that with the kazoo, please feel free. Please stand as we give Jesus all the glory. Thank you. all God's people said, please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And God's people said, amen. Once there was a man who for some time had suffered from various illnesses. He'd seen a number of doctors who performed countless tests on him and had prescribed lots of medicines. But his condition did not improve. He tried home remedies, drank herbal teas, and took mega doses of vitamins along with his prescriptions. Still, he did not feel any better than before. Then he heard of a physician who was said to be an outstanding diagnostician. Hundreds of people reported to this doctor that this doctor could diagnose and cure diseases of others who could not. The man called her and made an appointment. At last, he said to himself, I will be completely well again. The day of the appointment arrived. After the doctor had thoroughly examined the man and had reviewed his tests, she sat down with him and said, my friend, you are not a healthy man, but you can be well again if you follow my advice. What you need to do is lose about 60 pounds, get into a regular program of exercise, and eat more grain, fruit, and vegetables. You don't need to take any more of those medicines the doctors have prescribed for you, and you don't need all those vitamin pills. When the man heard this, he was furious. He demanded the doctor prescribe some new medicine for him, possibly some experimental drug not yet on the market, which would cure his illness. The doctor smiled patiently and repeated her advice. You don't need medicine, she said. You need to change your lifestyle. At this, the man cursed the doctor and stomped out of the office. And for the rest of his sickly life, he hated her and told everyone that she was a hoax who didn't deserve the title of doctor at all. Once, there was a woman who was in serious trouble with the law. She'd run up lots of debts, so in desperation, she embezzled some money from the company where she worked. The company found out and was now pressing charges against her. She had been spending most of her money on alcohol. In fact, she'd been arrested several times for driving while intoxicated. Her most recent arrest occurred when she caused an accident in which a passenger in another car had died. The woman was beside herself with worry. She didn't know where to turn until a friend of hers told her of an outstanding defense attorney who seldom lost a case. She called him immediately and she agreed to see her. She was delighted and relieved. At last, she said to herself, I will have a lawyer who will get all these charges dropped. Then I'll be able to get on with my life. But when she saw the attorney and explained her situation to her, she shook her head and said, what you did was wrong, and you may need to spend some time in prison. After you are released, you will need to get into an ongoing program of recovery from alcohol abuse. You will also need to get a steady job and repay the company for the money you stole. If you do this, you may be able to get your life back together again. The woman was outraged at the attorney. I don't need you to give me a lecture, she said. I need you to defend me against these charges and get them dropped. Whether or not I drink is my business, not yours. And with that, she dismissed her and began a letter-writing campaign to have her disbarred for refusing to help a client. In the meantime, she resumed her search for an attorney who would do what she wanted. Once, there was a small nation that was deeply troubled. For centuries, the people had been oppressed by foreign armies that controlled and dominated it. Many of the citizens of this nation had become cynical about life, and as a result, they even cheated their own friends and neighbors. It had become a dog-eat-dog society. There was no peace, no prosperity, no integrity in the land. Reform movements arose from time to time, but they soon failed for lack of support. But then there appeared a tiny ray of hope in the midst of the darkness. Little by little, people began to talk of the need for a Messiah who would fix everything for them. A Messiah who would overthrow the foreign army, establish a strong, independent government, and bring peace and prosperity to the nation. Suddenly, word came that there was a man from Nazareth, a carpenter's son, who was able to heal people, cast out demons, and even change water into wine. He drew large crowds when he spoke, and he could even hold his own against the scribes and Pharisees who confronted him. At last, the people said to themselves, "Here is a Messiah who will lead an army against Rome and reestablish Israel as a strong and prosperous nation. Here is a Messiah who will fix everything for us. Economically, politically, religiously." One day, this man rode a donkey into the capital city of Jerusalem. The people poured into the streets and cheered his arrival. They waved palm branches and spread garments on the road and shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven." That was Sunday. By Monday, things had begun to go downhill. This man had not even begun to recruit an army. He gave no speeches to arouse the rabble and unite them against Rome. He announced no program for economic recovery. Everyone waited. Nothing happens. Several days later, they grew angry and went on Friday when they learned this man was facing death at the hands of the Romans for treason. They filled the streets and shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Whether he had betrayed Rome or not, they did not know. But one thing they did know, he had betrayed them. The people got their wish. This man from Nazareth, in whom all the hopes of the people had been invested, this man from Nazareth, whom everyone expected would fix everything for them, this man from Nazareth, who was supposed to be the Messiah, the Savior, this man was forcefully and decisively executed. And when he died, all hope for magical, mystical, presto, change-o, quick-fix Messiah died as well. Our world has a history of denouncing and killing Messiahs who don't deliver what it wants. Moreover, our world does not want a God who is God over the world. Rather, The world wants a lapdog God that it can domesticate and control. The sweet God who indulges and bless the sickness, the sinfulness, the selfishness of this world. This world does not want a Messiah, or for that matter, doctors or lawyers or pastors or parents who give people what they need. The world wants a Messiah and doctors and lawyers and pastors and people who give people what they want. There are many sins, but there is really only one sin. And that is the sin of substituting another God of your own making for the one and only true God. When you devise a Messiah, a first joy of your own desire and imagination, and you worship that God rather than the true God, you sin. The only way you can be delivered from that sin is to have your false expectations destroyed once and for all. And that is precisely what happened between Palm Sunday and Good Friday. Jesus drew the false, sinful expectations of the world to himself, absorbed them, and bore them on the cross. His death was the death of all our false expectations, and therefore his death was the death of sin itself. The false piety of Palm Sunday is crucified on Good Friday and buried that night in order that true faith in God might rise on Easter through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Today, the church stands on the threshold of Holy Week. It is not for us now to rush ahead into Easter. Rather, it's necessary for us once again to undertake the surrender to Jesus of all our false hopes and selfish expectations. It is necessary for us to watch as our sin burdens him down on his head like a crown of thorns. It is necessary for us to see him die as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. It is necessary to suffer through the dark night of sorrow and death, if we are to enter by grace into the brilliant new light and life of Easter through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And all God's people say. In gratitude for Jesus, who takes away the sin of the world and gives all for us in the process, we gather our offerings for his service now and throughout our community. As we do so, we invite you please to drop in the offering plate your completed information cards or check in with us online using the QR code in the front of your bulletin. As we do so, we invite you to take part in what God is doing in our midst. For example, this week on Thursday, we will gather for worship. You heard in the video what you can expect and the special things we honor on that day. Then on Good Friday, we gather again at 7 p.m., a service of progressive darkness and sorrow as we see Jesus die anew on the cross. And then on Easter, we celebrate a worship service at 7 a.m., breakfast, and an egg hunt at 8:30 a.m., and a late service at 10 a.m. Please plan on joining us for that joyful time. And now we also want to tell you about what's happening in early April. Holly can tell you a little bit more, but we are doing something special as we gather in our public schools. We're praying about the opportunity to start an after-school kids club starting in the fall semester. What a great opportunity. This has been tested elsewhere, and we can help spearhead that in the Pasadena area. If you'd like to learn more, Please raise your hand, Holly Harris. Feel free to talk to her. It's exciting stuff. And then our praise and worship night is coming up also in mid-April. It is really special. A chance for us to gather here with special music and prayer and unstructured worship, and to also hear the stories of what God is doing in our midst. So we praise God for this opportunity. Don't miss out. 6 p.m. starting on April 14th, right here. Now we invite you to stand for private prayer, and then we'll speak to the Lord together. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we watch in wonder as we see your plan purposed before the creation of the world with the Son and the Holy Spirit, that our sin might be atoned for and laid on the cross of Jesus Christ, that we might be healed and restored and receive the true life you have prepared for all those made in your image. Help us in this holy week to marvel anew at your plan and purpose and its great cost through your Son. Not to rush ahead to Easter, but to give thanks and wonder for your great love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this nation that you have entrusted to our care. And we grieve to see so many things happening that harm others. But we also know that no single person is the Messiah of promise who can be our quick fix. Rather, we ask in prayer that you might do your will in our nation, starting with us, our hearts, our families, this congregation and community. Have your way with us, Heavenly Father, for the good of those around us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you and we praise you. And with the crowds we shout, Hosanna, save us now. But unlike the crowd, help us also to worship you as the one true King. Leaving our expectations and selfishness at the cross and giving you in our lives priority and honor as is your due and is our blessing as well. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Father, we thank and praise you for those who made in your image and restored by your Son Jesus who came to heal those who were sick and needing his touch. We lift up to you Mark and Juanetta and all those who are hurting, preparing for, or recovering from surgery. All those named in our weekly update who need your touch, Jesus, heal them, bless them, and give them your peace and patience. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, we rejoice with you in a way that the world cannot. The true, complete Easter joy fulfilled in all our celebrations, a taste of what is to come. Holy Spirit, we rejoice with those who rejoice. Jean and Jean joined together in holy marriage, and Logan, Hood, and Taylor, who will be united in holy marriage this coming week. May all our unions be a taste of the love, Jesus, you have for your bride, the church, and may all our celebrations be just a taste of the feast and celebration to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, Holy Spirit, we ask that you might give us children's joyful hearts, We ask that we might share the excitement and love we have in Jesus and invite others to experience Easter. So many people in our community don't know its true meaning, but are also waiting to be invited. Give us the courage and the compassion for our neighbor to invite others to join us for this day and join us in life as God's children. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we lift all for whom we pray, as we also pray the prayer Jesus taught all his followers to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. And all God's people said, Amen. We sing our final song together based upon the Lord's Prayer that we've been exploring this Lenten season as it is in heaven.
I will sing.